Thank you for joining us for this installment of the Women's Heart Health Summit. I'm honored to introduce you to my friend and colleague, Dr. David Brady. Thank you for joining us, David.
Hey, Mark, it's good to be with you. We've been good friends for a long time, so it's this is just like having a regular phone conversation, so it's great.
And you just returned from an international lecture tour, is that correct?
Yeah, I was lecturing over in Dublin, Ireland, and also in London. There's a lot of interest, particularly from the healthcare providers over there and the whole functional medicine model, because obviously they're in a nationalized healthcare system, which like our healthcare system is really good at certain things and not so good at other things, particularly complex chronic disease. So they're really taking keen interest in the whole functional medicine movement that is really, I guess, grounded here in the United States, but is really traveling very rapidly internationally.
Well, that's one thing I've always respected about your work, David, is you take very complex clinical problems and break them down into an individualized approach. And the reason I really wanted to have you join us is I do feel that a lot of the work that you do in those approaches has a lot to do with the outcomes of heart health. So I'm looking forward to our time today.
Yeah, absolutely. I'd love to be able to give you any of my experience in kind of dealing with patients in their journey toward optimal health. I have a lot of patients who see me just for that purpose. But then again, like you, I have a lot of patients that are coming in with really debilitating chronic, very complex medical conditions, have been to a lot of other providers before, you know, all kinds of different specialists, and even many other functional medicine providers, and they come eventually and see docs like us. So, you know, we see kind of the most difficult cases, I think, which is a challenge and a privilege, but it is never dull.
that's correct, and it seems what our next generation of clients is hopefully going to be people that don't want to end up sick like that or end up with heart disease or heart health problems. So let me do an introduction for you, David. Dr. David Brady has over 26 years of experience as an integrative practitioner and as an academic. He's a licensed naturopathic medical physician in Connecticut and Vermont and is board certified in functional medicine and clinical nutrition. Dr. Brady is a prolific author of medical papers and research articles on fibromyalgia and has dedicated a large part of his professional career to helping people recover from this mysterious disorder. He currently serves as the Vice President for Health Sciences, Director of the Human Nutrition Institute, and Associate Professor of Clinical Sciences at the University of Bridgeport in Connecticut. He maintains a private practice called Whole Body Medicine in Fairfield, Connecticut, is the chief medical officer for Designs for Health, one of the leading supplement manufacturers, as well as Diagnostic Solutions Labs, a leading laboratory analysis company. He's an internationally sought after presenter, as you mentioned, on nutrition, functional medicine, integrative medicine, and has appeared on the speaking panel of the largest and most prestigious conferences in the field. Dr. Brady is a highly dedicated champion and advocate for patients suffering with the fibromyalgia diagnosis. He's the author of the book, The Fibro Fix, which I have two copies on my shelf, one signed by you, thank you. One's actually on loan to a patient right now. And he's hosted the extremely popular, informative online Fibro Fix Summit. And you can learn more at drdavidbrady.com. That's D-R-D-A-V-I-D-B-R-A-D-Y, drdavidbrady.com. Also at FibroFix, FibroFix.com, FibroFix.com, and the FibroFixSummit.com. So David, again, an impressive biography, impressive background, and it's just always an honor for me to hear you speak and the way that you tie all these seemingly disparate ideas of individuals' health into a common thread.
Yeah, well, thank you, Mark. It's interesting. I do a lot of speaking and presenting and have for a long, long time. And a lot of people ask me, you know, how I developed my style in doing that. And I think it's a weird amalgam. It's a little bit of being a functional medicine doctor and a nutritionist, a little bit being an engineer and trying to make complicated things simple and make them work. And a little bit being an old touring musician, you know, rock and roll musician. So you throw that all together and that's what you get, I guess.
Well, you know, we talk here in our clinic about the symphony and the harmony, how woman needs to have balance of the pituitary, thyroid, adrenal, hormone, gut axis to allow her symphony to come into harmony. Where do you start when a client comes to see you with a seemingly complex problem, or if you want to try to dig in and provide a cardiac benefit, what's kind of your overall approach with someone like that?
Oh, well, it's a good question. You know, I, like you, and like pretty much every ambulatory care provider in the United States, the vast majority of the patients we see are women, right? Because women are much more likely to seek help for trying to improve their health, whether they have a significant problem already or whether they're trying to be proactively healthy. It's much more common for a woman to do that than a man. Usually a man is coming in because there's a woman in his life dragging him by a nostril, or, you know, there's something involving a power tool accident in the garage or something related to their genitalia. Otherwise, they're not coming in, you know. So we see mostly women. And women are, frankly, more complicated than men. They have much more complicated hormonal systems. They have much more complicated immune systems. And we'll talk about that a little bit, hopefully, a little later. But even though, you know, we have to sometimes get over our maleness and our male bias and how we approach women patients, because I do think that the medical establishment, by and large, over its development in the 20th century, has been all too dismissive of women as patients, women as study subjects. And luckily, or I guess thankfully, that's all changing. There are many, many, many more women physicians than there were 30 years ago. And I think that's a good thing. But here we are struggling to try to help a lot of women get better. And I think, you know, like any other condition, particularly complex chronic conditions, it all starts with their story, right? You really have to spend time. I mean, one of the problems with the current, you know, standard medical system is, you know, the data shows you got about 6 minutes with that provider. And what are they going to do? You know, if you have a complex chronic condition, they're not going to hear your whole story. They're not going to hear all the elements of your daily life that are contributing to your health condition. You know, they got 6 minutes with you. They're going to hear a couple of things, a couple of magic words. They're likely going to engage in one of the most efficient forms of communicatus interruptus known to humanity, which is the prescription pad, right? They're going to pull it out, write down one or two things and hand it to you. And now they've done something. They have permission to leave the room, right? To go to the next patient and do the same thing. And it's not that these providers are bad people. They're trying to do the best they can. They're really smart people. They're just kind of locked in a system. So to do the kind of model of medicine that you and I do, it takes a lot more time, and you have to get to know people a lot better. And to do that, you almost, unfortunately, you have to jump outside the system. You have to take a leap of faith and blow it all up and do a whole nother practice model. And that's what we do in the form of functional medicine. So we follow something called the functional medicine matrix, right? It's a sort of a way we've come up with to evaluate complex patients and to look at the totality of their existence, right? So a lot of it comes down to, you know, what was their upbringing like? What kind of stress were they under? What are their past experiences that have shaped their current state? How does that contribute to their health or lack of health? Mm-hmm. You know, detailed history on what do they eat? When do they eat? What kind of social support network do they have? What are the different things that are bothering them? So they're concerned about heart health, as they should be. Why? Do they have certain biomarkers or certain things that have been detected by other providers before? Do they have a family history? And if so, what is that family history? So there's a lot that goes into it. But I think, you know, in medical school, you know, in the first day, I think they tell you that proper diagnosis is half the cure, and that the most important element in the diagnosis is the history, is sitting and talking to someone. If you talk to somebody and you're really a good listener, and you don't just do all the talking yourself. I think, you know, 90% of the job gets done right there before you get to fancy diagnostics and imaging and lab tests and all of that. You can pretty much, particularly practitioners with a lot of experience like we have, you pretty much know.
You're right. You're right. The story really does tell the story. And, you know, we were taught in medical school that half of what we learn in the next 4 years will be proven wrong. We had to figure out which half. We're also taught how to see a patient every 7 minutes for 8 hours straight. And that connection is where you don't hear the story because the story is the story. And when you do hear that story, you really do get a deeper insight. You know, one of the classes that I'm most interested in is autoimmune disease. And one of your expertise is in working with those clients. As there's such a huge preponderance of women with autoimmune disease, it's something like 11 times more common in women?
Yeah, it depends on the autoimmune disorder, what the ratio is, but with very few exceptions, it's strongly slanted toward females, yes.
And our current therapies are not very good, not that effective, and are potentially dangerous. So looking at a different model that incorporates lifestyle medicine. The other issue is the autoimmune link and cardiac disease. There's a much, much higher risk of cardiac disease, particularly in women, particularly with autoimmune disease. How do you see some of this cross relationship of the inflammation of autoimmune disease and the inflammation of the heart kind of tying hand in hand with lifestyle medicine particularly?
Yeah, well, I mean, you just hit it. I mean, the core of a lot of these chronic complex diseases and metabolic states is a chronic state of inflammation. We know that cardiovascular disease, by and large, the majority of cardiovascular disease is driven fundamentally underlying the pathology as a state of inflammation. It was sold as, oh, it's cholesterol, it's the number. You know, it's really not. It's having maybe risky type of lipo particles, risky LDLs with certain characteristics, but bathe in an environment of inflammation. Then, you know, you're setting the stage for atherosclerotic disease and coronary artery obstruction and cardiovascular events, heart attacks, strokes, and so forth. But you really have to have that inflammatory component there. And if you have an autoimmune disease, by definition, you have a systemic inflammatory situation going on. So, you might look at cardiovascular disease, which is not thought of as an inherently autoimmune disorder per se, but it's an inflammatory disorder. If you have an autoimmune disease that's driving inflammation, you're setting the perfect stage for cardiovascular complications related to that autoimmunity. And I'm not convinced that cardiovascular disease doesn't have any autoimmune elements, because I think in certain circumstances it certainly can. But women are way more, as you said, afflicted by autoimmune disorders. And autoimmune disorders in general are rising at epidemic proportions in the Western industrialized countries, not so much in the underdeveloped world, moderately in the developing world as they take on Western diets, Western practices of hygiene, and other elements of our existence and lifestyle. But, you know, the woman's immune system is a lot more complicated than the male's by necessity, because women have to maintain a very robust immune response to stay healthy, but they also have to have a higher degree of immunotolerance than men, because they at times in their life may be carrying a foreign entity inside them known as a fetus. So, men's immune system would not deal with the fetus. It would freak out, right? So women, just like their hormonal system is a lot more complicated, their immune system is a lot more complicated. And at least theoretically, that is what makes women sometimes more susceptible to certain autoimmune conditions. For instance, we know that estrogen plays a role. Mm-hmm. 17-beta estradiol, a fraction of estrogen, is known to actually activate T cells of the immune system. And it can activate certain T cells that can produce inflammatory cytokines like IL-17, which can be very instrumental in driving autoimmunity. So we don't know all the answers on why females are more affected by autoimmunity, but we absolutely know they are. And in general, autoimmune diseases, I'll give you an example. inflammatory bowel disease, a classic autoimmune disorder of the intestines, which can cause things like ulcerative colitis, Crohn's is in that category, and so forth. At the turn of the 20th century, a little over 100 years ago, in the Western industrialized countries, or the countries that were industrializing at that time, the incidence level, as far as we can determine it, for inflammatory bowel disease was about 1 in 10,000 people. Today, it's 1 in 250 people. So that's an amazing difference. And you see the same kind of meteoric rise in the epidemiology of autoimmune diseases across all autoimmune diseases. It could be diabetes, it could be lupus, it could be MS, it could be autoimmune thyroiditis like Hashimoto's, it could be celiac disease, whichever it is, it's rising at incredible proportions. And it's not just genes, it's not just genetics. I mean, today we want to blame everything on genes, right? But genes don't change that fast. Our genes are not all that different than they were 100 years ago, but the incidence of autoimmune disease is orders of magnitude different. So there's something dancing with our genes in a different way that's creating the problem. So it's clearly an environmental issue. Something's changed about the environment we bathe our genes in. And there are a lot of hypotheses about that. When you look at the rising incidence of autoimmunity, it's so rapid that most epidemiologists would look at the graphs, you know, they're going like this, and they would think, uh-oh, there's an infectious outbreak going on, because that's the only thing that rises that fast. And indeed, as science has progressed, we're understanding autoimmune diseases in many cases as an infectious disease, because our immune system is reacting to external or environmental microbes, be they bacteria, viruses, fungi. It's reacting to the lack of certain microbes like parasites, like helminths. So we can talk about some of those relationships and why the landscape has changed, but it's really, really an interesting thing to follow. And now with the emergence of understanding to a greater level, the human microbiome, and particularly the gut microbiota, all those bugs that live in us, on us, and around us, and how they interact with our physiology, it is actually unlocking some of the mysteries behind why some of these things are occurring.
Well, you bring up so many great points, and you're talking about autoimmune disease and cardiovascular, and, you know, is heart disease really an autoimmune disease in a way, attacking the inner lining of the blood vessel? Right. They're now developing the same drugs they use for autoimmune disease, called monoclonal antibody inhibitors,
right,
to combat high cholesterol levels. It's about a $25,000 a year therapy. But it's interesting how you were seeing a lot of these crossovers. And there does seem to be an epidemic of heart disease and an epidemic of autoimmune disease. And the crossover may be the toxic environment that we live in.
Right.
You were mentioning this genetic drive. And one of the most powerful things for our listeners is this idea that you are not doomed to be your parents, that you're not doomed to be the genes that you carry. You have the ability to turn on some good ones and turn off some bad ones. And that's this concept of epigenetics. How do you use genetics in your clinical practice, and how do you describe it with your clients that helps them really want to jump in and make the lifestyle changes necessary to keep the bathing of the genes clean?
Oh man, that's an interesting question. You know, as practitioners these days, we all have patients who come in with their 23andMe raw data, right, and slap it on our desk, and it's that thick. And, hey, can you look at this? This is my genetic testing. And I don't sit there and go page by page through a 23andMe. Now, we'll take that data and port it into a really sophisticated artificial intelligence curation program known as Opus 23 that can really curate and pull the meaningful data out of that. But in the end, the genes are important, because the genes are analogous to the deck of, or to the hand of cards that you get dealt, you know, in poker, right? But you have to play the cards, and how you play the cards is what determines the outcome. Now,
yes,
it is true that you can get dealt a better hand initially or a poor hand initially. But you still have somewhat control of the outcome in how you play those cards. And if you play them right, you can still get a good outcome. If you play them wrong, particularly if you're dealt a bad hand to begin with, you're probably not going to have a great outcome. So no, you're not doomed to be your parents or to have your family history, but you probably are given a higher predilection toward different problems. So your genes are what is more likely to happen, what you have more susceptibility to have happen. But except in fairly rare instances, it's not determinant ultimately on what you will have. So we look at genes and we try to harvest the power of understanding risk profiles and where we have to triage or emphasize what's important to a person and how we change their lifestyle and their diet or what drugs we might use or what botanical medicines or nutrients we might use in their supplement program to play the hand better. But in the end, the genes aren't what's happening. The genes are what might happen if, you know, Venus aligns with Mars and you eat broccoli on Tuesday and you're under stress on Thursday. What we use a lot in addition to the genetic information is microbiome information, right? What's going on with those organisms we live with, particularly as it pertains to autoimmunity and inflammation. There's a lot of information there that we can leverage. But I think one of the most powerful things are the metabolome, the proteome, the inflammasome. These are all things we look at as well because they are more telling you what's happening now. Mm-hmm. What is really going on? Not what might happen, what is actually happening. So there are various metabolites we can measure, such as organic acids. There's different proteins we can measure, known as a proteome. There's different cytokines we can look at to determine, are you inflammatory or not? And what is your balance of these pro and anti-inflammatory cytokines? So that's the inflammasome. So we can look at all of these things, and we're getting to the point where we can take snapshots of these different things, genomics, microbiomics, proteomics, metabolomics, and mash them up with these curation informatics platforms, like one I mentioned, Opus 23 and Utopia. We use a lot of that. And it can really compare your data to the worldwide medical literature and to all of what are called the metadata sets that are publicly available and held by the government. So there's major data sets on the genome, on the microbiome, on the metabolome, and you can harvest connections and interactions between all of that data on a unique individual and use that to basically prioritize or triage what are the most impactful things you can do on this specific person. What kind of dietary strategy might they use? What kind of exercise strategy might be best for them? Because it's not the same for everybody. And then what's really powerful is what kind of supplement program, nutrients, botanical medicines would be most impactful for them, and what kind of medications, if you need to use them, would offer the best outcomes for them, and which kind of medications would they be non-responders to, or even which medications they're likely to have significant or serious side effects if they use.
Well, I would encourage all of our listeners to pause, rewind the last 5 minutes, and replay to your doctor what Dr. Brady just said, because you just heard the future of medicine. David, you really talked about this incredibly personalized approach to someone's health, looking at their metabolome, the proteome, their microbiome, looking at their genetics in a unique, personalized way that's actionable, figuring out drugs that will actually work better or ones they should avoid. Mm-hmm. These are not what we were taught in our training, but this is what functional medicine doctors are bringing to the table to their patients. Yeah. And that's one thing I hope that the summit and the book really do for our listeners is to really get them to demand this personalized level of investigation. What's beautiful.
Well, Mark, I'd even interject that I think there are a lot of providers out there that are not doing sort of the standard orthodox way of doing it, but are also, in my opinion, are doing a disservice to many people. And I'll give you an example. I know that there are practitioners of various types that are, for instance, taking 23andMe data or genomic information, what we call SNPs, single nucleotide polymorphisms, and based on SNP by SNP, giving very specific clinical information to patients to do different things. And I think it's the wrong way to go. It's very myopic. It's the antithesis of functional medicine, because it's like, I don't know, giving patients, you know, specific things to do. There are certain circumstances where this makes sense, but in large part, by looking at one SNP and telling somebody what to do is like taking the book War and Peace and reading one word out of one sentence, or maybe three letters out of one word in one sentence in this colossal book, and trying to write a book report on what the book says or what the book's about. It's so rabbit hole myopic. It's really not the way to go. Now, there's a lot of power in those SNPs when they're collectively looked at, and there's pattern analysis, and you look at it, but it's a much more complicated play than just going SNP by SNP and making these broad stroke recommendations. And you really, in my opinion, have to marry the genomic or the SNP data with the proteomics, metabolomics, and microbiomics to really get at a place where we can make, you know, powerful, evidence-based, meaningful recommendations to patients on what they change about their life.
Well, you're really talking about this personalized systems-based medicine, looking at the entire base of the patient with their genetics, with all of the other parts of their body and parts of their ecosystem that are all going to interact. And I tell a lot of my clients that we know just enough about genetics to be dangerous.
Yeah.
And you're right. A lot of practitioners will do a test and match a supplement to that individual test. All of a sudden people are taking 40 pills.
Right.
I love this concept of let food be your medicine, let kitchen be your pharmacy, let lifestyle be your physician. And what you're really suggesting is that we now have the tools to know what food you should eat, what lifestyle factors are best for you, and what you should put in your kitchen, and what you should not have in your kitchen or in your medicine cabinet. And I think this personalization is really not just to help the chronically sick patients that we sometimes see in functional medicine or someone with really bad fibromyalgia, but it's also the way that you're not going to develop a heart attack, not develop a stroke, not develop Alzheimer's disease, not develop diabetes.
Because that's where the real power is, right? The earlier you intervene, the easier it is and the better your outcomes are. So unfortunately, we're still in the state culturally where the majority of patients that come see docs like us are you know, crashed and burned. And they've been left, you know, without good options by the more traditional way of, or conventional way, I should say, of doing things. But, you know, more and more I see it turning where people are being very proactive about looking at these kind of things. And the whole sort of medical or health biohacking, you know, movement that came out of Silicon Valley with sort of biomonitoring and trying to optimize your things, I think sometimes that's taken to a bit of a silly extreme as well. I think the concept is a good one, and it's where we're going. And we're by no means perfect at this. I mean, in 10 years, we'll look at what we're doing today and kind of laugh, you know, and chuckle. But we're way more down the pike than many people would think. And even though, you know, a lot of this stuff is happening at the highest level of medical research, there's a massive disconnect, and there's at least a 15-year disconnect and a lot of financial stuff in the way, creating discord and disconnect between Western medical research, which I think is incredibly outstanding, and the conventional practice of Western medicine, which leaves a little to be desired, I think we can both agree, particularly when it comes to chronic complex disorders. They're great at acute stuff and trauma. I mean, they're just miraculous, right? And surgical procedures and things like that. So I'm not down on medicine in general. I'm glad we have the drugs we have. I'm glad we have all of the high-tech stuff we have. But, you know, for the vast majority of problems that the vast majority of people have, they're pathetically inept at dealing with them.
Well, you bring up such a good point with really what this summit is all about, is that you do good medicine when you need to do good medicine. And when you have acute problems, the medical system works really well in dealing with acute problems. But typically heart disease is this chronic problem, like diabetes is, like dementia is, like obesity is. These are all chronic illnesses that there's not a one single medication intervention that's going to change the entire world. Right. And you mentioned the biohacking, and I love it when people come in with their Fitbits, they have all this data and they've been online and looked up all this information. They have their 23andMe, they have all this information because these are empowered patients. And our first question is, tell us your story. And as you said earlier, most people have never heard their story told, and they don't have a practitioner that can put all the pieces of the puzzle from all of that information to the story that's unique to them.
Yeah, because the data is great. The data is great, but it has to be contextualized. The story is not going away. You have to understand what all that data means and what it's bathed in. I think we've seen the same kind of data on two different patients, and they have a totally different outcome or existence, right?
Well, we see that with stress as well. We had a huge snowstorm last year. We had snowed 4 feet and snow was everywhere. The first person came in and said, I love it when it snows like this. The trees are beautiful. The snow's so beautiful. I'm going to have a great day. The very next person walks in and says, I hate it when it snows like this. I'm going to slip and break my neck. So the same two, not just natural supplements, medications, but experiences, this internalization of the stress may change how you experience the activation of a medicine or a natural product. And you were talking about these chronic illnesses, and you mentioned toxicity just a little bit. We're now tying toxicity to obesity, to diabetes, to dementia, to heart disease. How do you, in your practice, assess someone's exposure toxicity, their total body burden of toxicity? How do you engage in clients with this whole nebulous concept or scary one of toxicity?
Yeah, it's a difficult one, but in the story, we try to find out what kind of exposures they have experienced, right? And did they have an occupational exposure? Do they have a living environment that may be full of mold or old house that they're restoring, lead paint? I mean, that's all easy, low-hanging fruit. But also, in a good exam, looking in their mouth, is their mouth full of old mercury-laden metal amalgams that are full of transitional metals that we know can drive autoimmunity and inflammation? So, in addition to, the standard medical tests, blood work that we would do, like any doctor would do to rule out systemic, disease and look at organ function and so forth. One of the tests we do a lot is organic acid testing, and there's a whole element on there because that kind of test doesn't tell you everything about anything, but it tells you a decent amount about a bunch of different foundational things. And one of the things that can tell you is not which toxins are there or not, but how is your biochemistry of detoxification working? Is your ability to clear things hindered in some way? And it's looking at some of the major routes or biochemical pathways of detoxification. So if that stuff looks like it's struggling, then someone is likely to have a higher body burden of a whole host of different toxins, because our detoxification mechanisms are by and large not specific to each chemical or toxin. There's a multitude of them, and you use whichever one seems to work for that particular toxin. But it's sort of a conserved system where you can test a few things and get a pretty good idea. Is this a robust detoxifier, or is this someone who's struggling in detox? And if there's someone who is struggling in some of those pathways, and some of that struggle may be because of a genetic sort of susceptibility, maybe you don't make as much of the enzymes that do that as the average person, or as you're getting older, you're making those enzymes structurally a little bit wrong. We call them warped enzymes, and they're just not performing well. So if you have a detoxification machinery, if you will, or biochemistry, for whatever reason, may not be as up to snuff as the average person, and you have a higher level of exposure, then you're one of those people who really may be slammed by toxins. So then based on that information, we may do specific testing on, different kind of organic solvents or pesticides, or we may look at heavy metal, challenges. It really depends on the circumstance in the patient. But we do quite a bit of that testing, and I'm lucky in that in my practice, whole body medicine, it's a group integrative practice, and within our same facility, it's sort of divided down the middle. We have the medical side, and then we have the dental side, and we have whole body medicine, and we have one of the world's preeminent biological dentists and his practice right there. So if we need to get amalgams out, if we need to do some greater testing on the whole dental side, and just dental health, oral health is of paramount importance to cardiovascular disease, obviously. If you have the wrong kind of microbes in your mouth, in your oral cavity, we know that that can drive systemic inflammation. And that is associated, lockdown statistically, you know, shown, the actuary data is there. If you have bad oral health, you will have higher chance of cardiovascular disease, cardiovascular incidence, strokes, and MIs. You will also have higher incidence of various autoimmune disorders. I'll give you an example. The bacterium most likely to cause periodontal disease or gum infection is P. gingivalis. And P. gingivalis actually produces an enzyme called PAD4, P-A-D-4, which alters proteins in your own body, and it's called citrullination, right? It adds a citrulline onto structures like collagen and vimentin and fibrinogen, mainly these tissues or proteins that make up your joint structure. You're kind of the glue that holds your body together. And it can actually alter those proteins, making your immune system no longer recognize them as you, which is a phenomenon called a hapten. And then your immune system attacks your own joints. So we know, for instance, that P. gingivalis overgrowth in the oral cavity is not only associated with, but causally linked to the genesis of rheumatoid arthritis. Now, it's not the cause of all rheumatoid arthritis. It's one of the possible causes of rheumatoid arthritis. And the average physician or rheumatologist trying to diagnose rheumatoid arthritis will often do a rheumatoid panel, which has something called rheumatoid factor on it and C-reactive protein looking for inflammation. But a test that's often on it is called an ACCP or a CCP, an anti-cyclic citrullinated peptide. It's actually a biomarker for this very phenomena of citrullinization that can occur due to these microbes that we may have growing at greater abundance in us that are deleterious. But they're doing the test to confirm a diagnosis. But when you ask them why they do that test and what that test means, they don't know. They just were told to do it in medical school, you know? So it's kind of interesting.
You bring up the why question. And I think what we do in functional medicine is we ask a lot of whys.
Yeah.
Because really anyone can test for rheumatoid factor and the CCP antibody you mentioned. But why is the rheumatoid factor elevated? Why is the CCP present? And digging deeper to look for where it is. You mentioned the oral microbiome and autoimmune disease. They found the bacteria from the mouth in the plaques that have caused sudden death in people. When they dissect the artery, inside the plaque, they find the DNA from these bugs. They're now linking the same bugs in the oral microbiome to dementia. Yep. And then the gut bugs, like Klebsiella, linked to ankylosing spondylitis. So, you know, looking at the mouth, looking at the gut, these are not things that happen in rheumatology offices.
No, I mean, when you look at autoimmune disease and rheumatology, let's go right down the middle. In rheumatoid arthritis, ankylosing spondylitis, psoriatic arthritis, you see overgrowth in the intestines at a much higher level in those subjects of Klebsiella, like you mentioned, Citrobacter, Prevotella, Proteus, E. coli in general. And then you ask yourself, how many people who go to a rheumatology service get a stool analysis, you know, to look for these bugs and to have anything look at,
No, they don't do it.
They say, the gastroenterologists do that, but they don't do it either. They'll do, if they do a stool analysis, they're looking for a very small, narrow thing of organisms that cause acute diarrhea. Otherwise, you know, you might get scoped this way and this way. If they don't find anything, a lesion that can be addressed with a procedure, then you get the purple pill and sent on your way. And that's not what the functional medicine gastroenterology workup is, that's for sure.
You know, we had a client that came back from a leading rheumatology center and was told that diet has nothing to do with her autoimmune disease.
Yeah, amazing.
I was just shocked that was a comment that could come out of a leading area, let alone really any rheumatology office. And you talk about the gut health. We've always talked about leaky gut, intestinal permeability, all these different bugs. When your company specializes in looking at these advanced panels, and really anyone, I think, with heart disease, diabetes, autoimmune disease, dementia, needs to have their gut looked at, their oral microbiome looked at like this, because if those two aren't balanced, I mean, there's 10 times more bacterial cells in your gut than human cells in your body. And that ecosystem of the microbiome with the good ones and bad ones has a huge balance of what's going to happen in your inflammatory processes.
Yeah, not only do those bugs outnumber us 10 to 1 at least, but their genome, the genetic material from them, outnumbers ours by orders of magnitude. It's crazy difference. And there, now we're showing there's lateral gene transfer, horizontal gene transfer across, you know, different microbes. And even with our own genome, it's a very complicated business we're just starting to understand. But you've been sort of chipping around the edges of the foundational elements here, and it doesn't really matter to a functional medicine doc, at least a good one in my opinion, what the patient's problem is, from cardiovascular disease to autoimmune disease to whatever. We know that there are certain tenets or foundational elements that you have to get optimized in an individual to give them the greatest chance of being healthy. And two of the things that, you know, our mentor, Dr. Jeff Bland, has been talking about for decades is, does someone have a robust ability to detoxify what's deleterious to them that they're either exposed to exogenously from the outside, or all of those toxins that we all make inside endogenously, right? We, even if we're totally healthy, we're making toxins all the time, metabolites. We have to clear hormones. We have oxidative stress just by making energy in the mitochondria. So you have to support good, healthy, robust detoxification, number one. And if there are obvious toxins there, mercury, I mean, whatever it may be, you should try to clear that as much as possible and lower the body burden. But parallel to that, there's probably nothing more important than testing, optimizing the gastrointestinal environment. Not only the bugs, the microbes that live there, the GI microbiota, but also the health of the GI intestinal lining. And that's where the whole concept of leaky gut and hyperpermeability come in. If you're leaky, it's like a sieve. It's like, you know, it's as if the sewage drains in your house had holes in them, and it was just allowing it to come back in the house. I mean, it's not a good situation. If
that's the analogy,
very, very common for that to be with the use of all the medications, non-steroidal anti-inflammatories, antibiotics, lots of alcohol, you know, highly processed foods. I mean, we can go and stress. Can go on and on and on. The Western industrialized existence is one that's deleterious to the gut health. And if you go back to even some of the great thinkers 100 years ago, Metchnikoff, right, you know, who's the father of modern day probiotics, who coined this term we use now called dysbiosis, he understood very early by studying what we now call blue zones, right? Places, these pockets where people live really long and really well, right? He found one in Bulgaria, right, in the mountains of Bulgaria, as you know, and it was this pocket of people who lived well over 100 years of age, which at the time was unheard of, and they were active, they were vibrant all the way till the day that they finally took their last breath, and he looked at what they do different, and it was all the classic stuff of the blue zones, right? They were really highly valued as elderly in their tribe, right? They weren't shoved aside. They were sought out for great wisdom. They were valued. They kept working. They did what they did. They didn't retire and sit around the house. They were out tending to the animals and in the fields. But he also looked at, they had a tight social network, right? They stayed together. And, but the big difference he saw in their dietary input was that they had these wonderful cows or animals that fed on these pristine pastures, and they would take the raw milk, not pasteurized milk, raw milk, and then they would make these cultured products out of it, like yogurts, kefirs, things like that, and they consumed a massive amount of this stuff, and he thought it was something in that, and it turns out that they were, you know, full of probiotic organisms, and that's how still, if you look at a lot of probiotic supplements you may see on it, Lactobacillus bulgaricus. It was from this Bulgarian experience. So it's amazing how back then probiotics got a lot of, you know, attention and publicity in standard orthodox medicine. But then, as you know, with the advent of antibiotics and other types of things and real chemical pharma-based financial model in medicine, a lot of that wisdom just melted away. But it's back. It's back because the data and the objective science is telling us it needs to be back.
Well, you make such good points of how our gut really is under attack, under from so many things, the stress of our culture, the stress of our lifestyle, the food that we eat, the lack of nutrient, the content of toxicity, the lack of the good bugs, the preponderance of the bad bugs. And when we talk about the diet with the blue zones, we've talked a little bit in the past about the Mediterranean diet and how much of it is the food versus how much of it is the social gathering of the meal and the support of the meal and the support of the family. I want to ask you just a couple of questions for our listeners. If someone asks you, Dr. Brady, what do I eat? I can't afford tests. I don't want to do any tests. Tell me what to eat. What diet should I go on? We don't like the word diet because of the first three letters or die. But how do you help someone get started making a nutritional shift in their health?
Well, I wish there was an easy answer to that. And a lot of people are agenda based in their diet, and they'll give you that, paleo or keto now, or, you know, Mediterranean or whatever it will be. What the blue zones have shown us and what different cultures around the world have shown us is that there are many different ways of eating that can be very healthy for humans. But you hit on it. It's not just the macronutrient composition or the name of the diet of the week, you know, that you're eating. It's how you contextualize the food. But I think there are some common foundational sort of elements to it. You should eat real food, not science food. I mean, that's really simple, right?
Sure.
If you're picking up a box or a can and it's got, you know, 20 things listed in ingredients, you can't pronounce half of them, don't eat it, man. It's, you know, one of my nutrition mentors way back, you know, taught me a very simple test for myself, but for patients. And he said, look at the plate when you're about to eat. And ask yourself one question. Could you have got the food that you're eating in the form that it's in on your plate 100 years ago? And if the answer
great
is
point.
No,
that's great. Eat,
right? So different dietary constructs from a macronutrient standpoint can work for different people. Some people do great on a, you know, high protein, lower carb diet, whether it's a paleo diet or a higher fat diet like a keto diet, particularly if they have certain medical challenges, if they have epilepsy, if they have bipolar, if they have whatever it may be. I think by and large, if I didn't know anything about anybody and was trying to find out what I think would probably be the most rational way to tell them to eat, would be a Mediterranean diet. It's got healthy fats. It's got tons of phytonutrients. It's got quality proteins. It doesn't have a lot of junk carbohydrates in it. It's got carbohydrates that are real with lots of fiber. The macronutrient balance is great. There's lots of things like olive oil and nuts and seeds. And, you know, it's got a lot going for it. And you mentioned those cultures have a good relationship with food. You know, they don't overeat, and food is sacred. Food is not to be monkeyed with. You know, it's got to be real. And there's a social element to all gathering and eating together. And I think there's incredible value in that. And, you know, we have all these incredible nutritional scientists around the world, and the popular media will often say, well, you know, none of these cats can get along, right? They can't agree. And I don't think that's true. I think the predominant nutritional scientists around the world do generally agree with what I just said, which is there are different dietary styles that may work for different individuals, but there are these commonalities. There's the acorn in the middle, right? Where all these diets overlap, and where they overlap when they're healthy is real fresh foods, not science foods, not foods created by the food industry. That you have that good relationship with food, and it's not totally extreme one way or the other. But I think probably someone who encapsulated it best is not a nutritional scientist at all, but an investigative author in Michael Pollan, right?
Yes.
What was it? Mark, you can help me with this, but he said,
eat food, real food, mostly vegetables.
Eat food, not too much, mostly plants, right? And something like that. But
he also said, eat your lunch at a table and your desk is not a table. That's one of my mantras.
Right. But, you know, one of my good friends at Yale, David Katz, also talks about the whole thing of fingers, forks, and feet, right? Fingers, forks, and feet. So to stay healthy, use your fingers in a good way, which is not like this, right?
Uh-huh.
make sure what's on your fork is good, and use your feet. Keep moving. Keep moving. Don't smoke. Eat good, real foods, and you'll be fine.
Well, a lot of these ideas and these pearls from our world's expert, Dr. David Brady, here are things that you can do every day. And that's what I like, is when we've talked deep dive into the science, but then also bring it down to the just the basic things that people can do on a daily basis. It's about clean food, clean air, clean water. It's about using your feet, recognizing how you use your hands, and eating whole food. And really, a lot of what we're doing for heart prevention is what we're doing for all of the chronic illness prevention.
Because absolutely. I think you and I, it's a chronic inflammatory disease. And ironically enough, you know, I know, you know, the current medical model is to statin everybody to extremely low cholesterol levels, which I have a major problem with. I think they're overused, overprescribed. When they are used, they're used at too high of a dose. Mm-hmm. They cause a massive amount of myalgia, fatigue, and a lot of women come in to me with the diagnosis of fibromyalgia, and they really have, they're overstatined, basically. And I'm not totally against statins. I think the data on them for secondary prevention, once you have a heart attack, is pretty good. I think the data on them for primary prevention to be used with the general public for people who have not had a heart attack is woeful. It doesn't support the way they're being used. I think the number to treat to avoid an event is in the hundreds, several hundreds.
It is.
But I think where statins do work, particularly in secondary prevention, ironically enough, is not lowering that number of your cholesterol, but they have inherent pleomorphic effects, which means they're deep tissue anti-inflammatories. They are getting at the inflammation, similar to how vitamin D works, similar to how like low dose naltrexone is being used now in autoimmunity.
Very interesting.
But I think statins have effects that are not based on the mechanism of action that they were approved on, that imparts some of the benefit. But we can get that lowering of inflammatory benefit without using those kind of agents if we just live a lifestyle that makes more sense. We eat real food.
Yes.
We have good social support networks. We keep moving our feet. We're not full of toxins, and we have good, healthy GI microbiomes. I mean, it can bring you a long, long way.
And I know you see this in your practice, where I'll have a woman come in that wants to prevent heart disease, and we'll go through the anti-inflammatory program and personalize her care. And when she comes for a follow-up, we said, well, I like what I'm doing because I'm sleeping better, and my knee doesn't hurt anymore, and my skin cleared up, and my sexual desire is higher, and I'm just happier. And so all of that is all related. And right. I think for those of you listening, I hope you got as much out of listening to Dr. Brady as I did. It's always a pleasure talking with you, David. Your patients are very fortunate to see you. You bring so much to the clinic for them. And if people want to learn more about you, how would they find you, David?
Well, probably the best way is just my main website, drdavidbrady.com. As you said, drdavidbrady, B-R-A-D-Y.com. And if you struggle with chronic pain, think you may have or been told you have fibromyalgia, another great resource would be my website, more specific to that condition, which is FibroFix, FibroFix.com. And of course, I have a book by that name as well. So if you're in that situation, that might give you some great resources. And I would just advocate you really find someone, a really good practitioner to work with that you resonate with, that you just yes. know is the right person. So find a good functional medicine trained provider. You know, if you can go see Dr. Mark, certainly do that. But if not, find a functional medicine provider who's certified by the Institute for Functional Medicine. And on their website, you can just Google Institute for Functional Medicine. They have a find a practitioner tool where you can find a certified provider.
Well, that's great. And David, thank you as always. Your insights are amazing. And thank you very much for being here. And until the next time of the Women's Heart Health Summit, look forward to seeing you again.